everybody, hi. Once again, thank you for watching Sunrise of Nevada. I am Bruce Muffs in LCSW, and we're now going to do another song by Triple X. Everyone knows who this figure is. I'm not going to get into his real name. He's really actually better known by Triple X, so we're going to go score X. So we're just going to go forward in that direction the entire time I break down the song and go over things clinically. Unfortunately, as everyone knows, unless you live under a rock or in Mars, he was shot and killed in the middle of June, June 18th. He had a very, very short life. He was born in January of 23 of 98 and was killed in basically a carjacking June 18th, 2018. Basically, he was, one of the things I had to step back and when I listened to his song over and over again, it's going to be Floor 555, is how young he was. I had forgotten about that. He only lived 20 years. But really, in his 20 years, it's like he lived 80 years because there was so much going on in his life. There were so many incidents. Now, he was described, this is from Wikipedia, thank you, Wikipedia, a controversial figure within the hip-hop industry. He'd been regarded to have left behind a huge musical footprint due to his impact on his young fan base and his popularity during his short career. No argument. Now, I want to go right into his song in this case because the song is just so boom, boom, boom. And I want to go over the lyrics, and I want to go over the reaction to the song, and I want to compare and contrast another song from about 35 years ago to give you an idea of where I see why he was so popular, why he was so heavily regarded, and why his fans lionized him. I mean, what's interesting to me is that I was not aware or even thinking there would be that kind of mass outpouring of grief for him, that he actually had an open casket. And that thousands of fans lined up to pay respects to him. I knew he was popular. I didn't know he was that popular. But after listening to his music, listening to a lot of interviews, reading a lot of comments about him, I have a better understanding of why he was the voice, in a sense, of this young generation. And had he lived, he probably would have been seen as the next heir apparent to being like the leader or the father of the next phase of rap. Okay. The song is called Floor 555. Interestingly enough, 555 has spiritual connotations. And if you go to any kind of, and YouTube, of course, has everything in the world in there, there are actually videos about the spirituality of 555, that it means that you're a great person, you're doing wonderful things. So 555 has a huge spirituality content to it, and you can look that up. And just various forms of how people look at it from a meditative and a, you know, understanding of yourself, what those words, what those letters mean. So I don't think he chose 555 at random, basically, to say it from that angle. Okay, he goes, it starts off with, I'll put one in that chamber, lay you in the face of God, know to be faced a blank, blank, you know, fake, all right. F is feeling God level, I'm feeling odd. Fairly, Beverly, Beverly Hills, West Side, you know, blank, I'm doing your neighbor, daughter at Best Buy. If I hit up your jack, then blank, you best slide. If you're toting that pistol, you best ride, blank. If you shoot that at me, blank, I'd best die because I'm a blank narcissist. What's very interesting to me is listening to this song as I did over and over and over again, I thought, my God, those lyrics foretold his death. That's exactly what happened to him, how he was killed. He was killed in basically a carjacking. He went to look at a motorcycle, and as he left, his car was blocked, and two guys, armed guys, got out, pulled guns on him, a struggle ensued, and they shot him multiple times, and they stole the Louis Vuitton bag. But if you listen to this, this is exactly how it happened to him, almost like he wrote his own death. Trouble, tremble, you catch a clip with that. And then he goes with the boy, don't be talking blank. You can meet this AK. It got kicked back because I'm a blank Martian in the heart of a mosh pit. Put that boy in a coffin because the way that he's talking. Blank boy, don't be gawking. I ain't doing no barking. I let it rip his, you know, his blank in the parking. Again, very, very similar to what happened. He got into a war of words, and they shot him. They tussled over the bag, and they blasted him. He was shot multiple times and died on his way to the hospital. So it's like he's foretelling his own future. And then at the last part of the song is blank, don't, you know, it's like blank boy, don't test me, don't test me, don't test me, don't test boy, don't test. And a lot of just don't test me, don't test me, don't test me. And it ends up with I. And I realized listening to this song multiple times, and when I learned what this song was, I listened to it over and over again. Why is this song so popular? It's not just a song, it's a war cry. And it got me pumped up. Ready for battle. Like, put this song on before we go into war. Before we go into conflict. Because why? His life was a constant battle. To prove himself. Because the lyrics, don't test me, don't test me, don't test me, don't test me, don't test me. Where you challenge me, you challenge me, you challenge me, you challenge me. People put together Magna, and they put cartoons to this song. And every one of the Magna cartoons that I saw were violent. It all ended in conflict between the characters, like this, like they're like this. You know, the Japanese with the big eyes, like this, like. And then they would attack each other, you know, slam each other into the ground, fighting. Always young kids, mostly muscular boys with a grudge to prove, who turning into demons and dragons and werewolves. Fierce. You're fierce already. But when your character takes over, you got spells, you got powers, you could do more with it because you're raging, you're getting angry. And that's what I saw with cartoon after cartoon after cartoon set to these words, and it made total sense. It clicked. There's a guy I'm going to quote in a second named Lord Izzy, who talked about listening to this song as a reviewer and what he said about how it made him angry, ready to fight. And I see exactly where it's coming from. This was written as a call to arms to join me. And this is why his music was so relatable and so many young people appreciated his lyrics, because they would talk. He was talking about himself, and what he didn't understand inadvertently was he was talking about his fans. And that's why they poured into his concerts. They downloaded his music. They bought his albums, because he represented them and how they feel about their life. Now, there's this reviewer I was watching on YouTube named Lord Izzy, and he listened to the song. And the way he has his channel set up is he listens to the song and he would respond to it. And he went like this. He said, "Don't play the song around me if I'm drunk, because someone will get hurt. I will do something to someone. I want it to go crazy." And he's in his bedroom, and he's like jumping on his bed and doing backflips. "I could beat myself up. I loved it." And in the comment section, I'm a big comment reader, they all felt the same way. Bang, 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 bang. Now, there's actually a thing here, parents reacting to Triple X. They have a thing where parents listen to music, generally rap music, whatever, or rock music, and they have to give their opinion on what they're listening to. It's middle-aged people like me. And it's, you know, all walks of life, white, black, brown, blah, 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 moms, dads, male, female. And it goes like this. The parents are like, listen to, "Oh my God, I can't believe this." Here's what goes. A comment from X Ninja Blaze. "Some adults will never understand how important music like this is to the new generation." Another comment, Leia, L-E-I-A-H. "I don't think adults understand that some of us use his songs to let our emotions, to relate, and to just calm down." And you know what? I get it. The lyrics don't make me go, "Oh, oh, oh." I get the message. We're relatable, relating, because so many kids that I work with feel just like him. Just felt like Triple X. Just felt like his fans. And when you're in a depressed state of mind, when you think of yourself in so negatively, in such negative terms, that music makes you feel that someone is writing something that's talking about me. Because what is music ultimately is an emotional connection from the artist to the listener, to the participant. And when the music clicks that you feel like, wow, I feel that connection, it either can put you in all kinds of state, but his state was a state of war, a state of preparation, a state of battle. And when kids have lives of chaos all day long, you know, my life doesn't mean anything. I feel empty. I feel helpless. I feel hopeless. I don't feel like a person. Well, that makes total sense to me. The lyrics flow. You know, don't test me. Don't test me. Because what you're really saying is how you feel about yourself. Because if you test me, you may find me wanting. So the Japanese cartoons of like this, like, get yourself into a rage, because that's how many kids feel the way that they do. And ironically, not too far from where he grew up was the shooting in Florida, the high school, where a kid felt impotent, unhappy, lousy student, not condoning his actions by any means, of course, but went into the school with weapons to kill. So it's not that dissimilar how people feel around the world today when you're an adolescent. And I see this all the time working with adults who were once kids, working with kids and just seeing the angst, the frustration, the anguish, the confusion, and they're begging for someone to say, hey, give me something to hold on to. And that music makes so much sense to me. Like, it's not like I'm supposed to be, I'm not going to respond to the F word or to the N word, which I don't say, but I get it. I understand how the visceral reaction to hearing those lyrics is like, someone gets how I feel about my life on a day-to-day basis. Now, so in going over the lyrics to me, it makes sense why his lyrics are so popular and why his death resonated with so many of his fans. His lyrics reflect the world that his fans find themselves in. His struggle for control and acceptance fits in perfectly with the views that his fans just write about above. They don't feel they fit in. His pain is their pain. His anger is their anger. And his need to control his own destiny is that of his fans feeling that he speaks for them, and that is what they're going through. They're going through the same emotions, so no control. I thought about the anger and his frustration, his lyrics from you know, Floor 555, and I thought about a song that I remember when I was a kid that had responded with me, like that resonation of like, wow, this song is relatable. And it was a group called Queen, which right now there's a bio about the lead singer, Freddie Mercury, and about the band and blah, blah, blah. And the song was called We Will Rock You. But back then, of course, this is in the Twilight Zone. There was only radio. There was no internet, blah, blah, blah. You got cassette tapes at that time. But the song was played everywhere. And you still hear it in anthems if you're in sports stadiums or, you know, at high school events. We will rock you. And everyone starts to clap, okay? It's been around forever. And while it's far from being, you know, the only anthem that's ever been written about kids getting tough, about teen struggles to be respected, it was for its time one of the biggest hits. And again, you can still hear it all over. All right. Here are the lyrics to Queen. All right. And I'm not going to focus on the main ones that got people so inflamed back then. You got mud on your face, you big disgrace, kicking your can all over the place. And here's the anthem part. We will rock you, clap, clap, and then we will rock you. I'm flashing back, actually, when I had hair. And I was actually happier. Joke. Okay. And then the next verse is shouting in the street, gonna take on the world someday. You got blood on your face, you big disgrace. Then we will rock you. And then the last, it's not even a long song, it goes in like different parts of someone's age. It's like you're a boy, you're a young man, now you're an old man, pleading with your eyes, gonna make you some peace someday. You got mud on your face, big disgrace. Fine. And then it ends with, we will rock you, you know, blah, blah, blah. Here's the issue. When they wrote this song, Queen, it was musicians writing a song. That's all it was. It was musicians writing a song. What happened here is that for Triple X, it wasn't a song. He was writing about his life. And that's what the fans realized. As great as We Will Rock You is, and it's going to be played till the Messiah comes, and I'll still probably play it after that, is that the reason why his fans would riot and there'd be, you know, chaos when he performed was because he tapped into something that they were feeling. It was not a singer and his audience. It was a symbiotic relationship. He was speaking for his generation of divorce, alienation, teen suicide, teen cutting, overdoses, opiate addiction, destroying families, financial issues at home, chaos. That song was his life. And when you went to his show, whether or not your life was like that, you felt on how you were living was a connection to him. And that's very, very rare from a performer to bring to an audience. It happens once in a lifetime. That's what made his music so powerful. And that's how he expressed his life in his music. Now, I want to talk about a clinical aspect of looking at his early life. Again, when I say early life, he only lived to 20. His life had a huge influence on his lyrics. Raised by his grandmother, mother unable to provide for him. At 6 years old, he tried to stab a guy who was attempting to attack his mother. He was in a youth program. Okay, that's i.e., that means a group home, okay? And he was forced to live with his grandmother. Kicked out of school, attacked another student. Middle school, he was expelled. Series of fights. Sent to Sheridan House. Okay, that's mental health speak for another group home. For 6 months. Dropped out of high school in the 10th grade. He felt he was a misfit. Regularly involved in physical confrontations. He felt insecure and depressed at school. He was in juvie. Why? Gun possession charges as he attacked a homosexual cellmate. All this before the age of 18. Okay. What was his tours like? He didn't tour that much because he was so young. But in April of 2017, what were some of the issues? One of the rappers that he knew was assaulted. Well, it was a rapper that was assaulted. He was knocked out after a fight on stage. An audience member was stabbed. He was thrown into a barricade by security. He punched a fan. He had a cousin that was shot and killed. Legal issues. In 2016, he's charged with robbery and assault with a deadly weapon. Another arrest on charges of false imprisonment, witness tampering, and aggravated battery on his pregnant girlfriend. With his death in June 18, how did he pass away? As we said about before, two men followed him to a motorcycle dealership in Florida, and they got out. They blocked his car from leaving, came around the sides. They reached inside his car. They stole the small Louis Vuitton bag, as I said before, shot him multiple times. Several weeks later, three people have been arrested for it. You know what's crazy to me is I wonder, and I hope not, that those guys that shot him were not listening to Floor 555 before they went out to get pumped, to get psyched. The irony of that, what that would have been. What is his legacy? That's kind of curious, you know, how is he looked apart? And they said that he brought attention to mental health because he talked about his mental health issues. He introduced distortion and heavy metal and heavy guitar, backed instrumentals, and drawing inspiration from third wave emo. Very popular. Here are my clinical observations of X, Triple X. His life was extremely dysfunctional, and he was really 20 going on 80. It's amazing how many times I have sat with my producer when we would go and we'd be in homes, and it was amazing to me how many times we ended up talking to moms outside a house. My daughter's messed up. My son's doing terrible. I have no control. My kids are driving me crazy. They don't respect me. They curse at me. They spit at me. My husband's not around. My boyfriend left me. I just have chaos in the house. I don't have enough money to get through the month. And we're listening to this stuff, and we're trying to make sense of it and trying to understand it. But at least on some level, there's a mother involved. Forget about him not even having a father around. He didn't even have a mother around. There was no one raising this kid. And he really was a kid. And you realize what that does to you, what that does to your psyche, what that does to you emotionally when you don't have a parent that's even semi-functional to look after you. His music was brilliant, no argument, and his life ended way too short. But the fights, the feuds, his on and off relationship with his music and with his friends was, to me, him crying out for help. Help me with my own confusion. He wanted someone to look out for him. There was nobody. You look at his life, when you read it, you know, what went on. He basically did everything on his own and clearly had no stable adults in his life, because it doesn't seem to bring up anyone who was an adult that was had any control over him to guide him. What was going to happen? It was a recipe for an early disaster. It was a given. To me, I'm always going to wonder what he could have done as an artist if he grew up with stability in the home and a father to rein him in and say, why are you even getting a motorcycle for? Let's get something used off of eBay. What are you wasting your money on a $1.5 million home? Who's going to live there? Taxes are going to be insane. A father to hug him and kiss him, to give him the guidance that he didn't have. Would he be the ex that we now know? Good question. Would his music have been softer? Very possibly. Could he have taken his influence from the emo and the heavy metal and the heavy guitar? Undoubtedly. But we'll never know because his life was cut short so quickly. It was like a candle. You blow out. That's what's so sad about the whole thing. But in a way, he never had a chance from the time he was born to the time he was dead, to died. His trajectory, you could see, was not going to be long-lasting. And that's what's so disappointing. People wrote about his death because he was such a yin-yang in so many different ways about himself emotionally. And they said that he's going to be remembered. This is from The Guardian, again from Wikipedia. That the unusually cruel violence he committed on vulnerable people, particularly his ex-girlfriend. There's an article in The Atlantic about him, another magazine, that says that he gave voice to their insecurities. Also, his legacy is nonetheless characterized by the trauma he both experienced and caused. In the Washington Post, that's a newspaper, Chris Richards commented on Onfray's complicated legacy, ex's legacy, contrasting how he encouraged his fans to find hope in the fog of their despair, but bragged enthusiastically about the joy he felt in brutalizing others. According to Richard, his music brought solace to the depressed while validating the sort of violence he practiced and legitimized the pain of his fans while erasing the suffering of domestic violence victims. So he's going to go down as having caused a lot of trauma to a lot of people. You know, I can't stress enough how important fathers are to the mix. I really can't. And it's just kind of depressing. Not the fact that he's dead, horrible. But the three men who shot him, if not more, I guarantee you there's no fathers in their lives as well. Aimless and lost. The older I get, the more I realize that fathers that are normal are like an endangered species. There's so few of us out there. And by no means am I saying I'm a perfect father. I try, believe me, I make tons of mistakes, but I try and be there every single day for my kids. because I know how important it is to have that male role model in your life. Because if you don't have it, you're doomed. It is so difficult to break that cycle of having to learn everything on your own, because you get smashed in the face so repeatedly. What's harder today more than anything clinically is that kids today don't have the luxury of getting older without stresses hitting you so much earlier. I was once a kid myself, and, 60 pounds ago, and I was able to kind of look at things, in a slower venue, slower vein. I didn't have the internet to worry about, I didn't have my phone. Those things didn't exist. Now it's part of my life, and now it's part of kids' lives, and things are like so quicker now, so hyper, so fast, that you're constantly being bombarded with messages that if you don't have an adult around you to guide you appropriately, you tend to crash and burn. And that's what I try and avoid when I'm doing counseling with adolescents in particular, is not to hit the wall at 80. But when you don't got a dad around that can show you not how to just how to throw a curveball or how to change the oil, how to tip a weight or how to put a tie on, how to be a man. And these moms are just exhausted, wiped out, and destroyed trying to take on both roles. Like playing offense and defense in football. You get wiped out. Very few people can go back and forth because it's so specialized. But that's what's happening. And they're so important and they're so overlooked. And I feel as great as he was with a stable family that cared about him, that had their own life together, he could have been even better. I'm not giving him a pass on the crimes he allegedly did or didn't do. That's the court to decide. If he did them, he did them. I'm not going to argue about that. I'm not going to get into the lawyer nonsense. And ultimately, he would have to take the responsibility for what he did. Not arguing about that for one second. But when you don't have guidance, you are lost. That's reality. How would I judge him clinically if I had to evaluate him? Again, not knowing he wasn't my patient. But to me, it was clear. He suffered from PTSD, depression, trauma, stress, and anxiety, and a very, very dysfunctional childhood. You want to make a recipe out of it, add all those different ingredients, you're going to get a cake that's going to be poison. That's the reality. Dads, if you're watching this, and I hope some dads are, or people who are dad-like or think they're going to be a dad one day, go out and make a difference in your kid's life. If you haven't seen him in 10 years, drop him a text. Make a phone call. People still send letters. Write a letter. Show up. Be involved. Because your kid needs you more than you will ever, ever know. And they may say you suck, you're stupid, you're old, you're dumb. But what happened to this guy, what happened to X, could have been preventable. Left behind a great body of work, no argument. What life cut way too short. But also, because again, of his upbringing caused a lot of havoc to a lot of other people. Allegedly were not. He still was involved in a lot of other things. And he ultimately met his demise, how ironic, through violence. And just going back again is what you put together. You put together a poison cake. You eat it, you're going to die. I'm just saying out there, dads, if you want to be a dad, get yourself fixed up first mentally and clinically and emotionally before you have children, because it's the most important responsibility you're ever going to have. And I'm going to close with this on this song. Of all I've accomplished in my life, and I've done a fair share of things that are interesting and, creative, blah, 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 financially rewarding, my biggest joy, my biggest accomplishment was having 3 children. That's it. Everything else pales in comparison. As I was a father, I still am a father, to these kids. I've had plenty of tragedy in my life, but the fact that I had 3 children, there's nothing even comes close to that. So hear what I say, listen to it, listen to his music, look at the lyrics differently, and then try and go forward in a positive way. Thanks for watching.